I have to, like, I need to get some, like, fucking, I don't know, washers or something.
Some what?
Washers.
Yeah. Like, do it.
There's, like, this, only on one of the arms of my chair does, like, the screws not, like, hold the chair arm up that good anymore.
You should just contact the company you bought that from and be like, I paid this much money for your shit. Send me washers, you assholes.
Send me a new arm.
They'll probably send you... Honestly, they'll probably send you a replacement part for free based on how much money you spent on it.
Yeah. I probably have washers in my...
Just saying.
Stuff.
Ask Papa Meyer and be like, yo, you got washers?
I mean, yeah, he probably does.
He'd be like, no, fuck off.
No, fuck off.
Don't speak to me. Here's a calzone.
That was funny.
Here's $500.
Here's $500 in
thanks,
two calzones.
Thanks, Dad. Oh, it's like it's his fault that calzones are now an official extra life tradition.
That's true.
Next year, if I have to buy a calzone, I'd be like, fuck, god damn it. Gotta buy a
god
calzone because it's a fucking
transition
now. Should have talked about it so much in the podcast. Shit.
Fuck.
Like Orpheus fund this shit. Orpheus 2 underscores. Ooh. Well, that's strong.
Oh, yeah?
Ooh, yeah. Go to podcast again?
Yes.
Joke's on you. We've already been podcasting.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, I'm back. I got a drink. I made Vlad's famous quick sangria, but this time it's a peach sangria.
Ooh.
Because a long time ago, I bought peach schnapps and never drank them.
Yep, you did.
So here's the great thing about buying too much alcohol. It doesn't go bad.
You drink it?
It doesn't go bad.
Oh.
And you just keep it in your closet forever. Like the SoCo that I have. One time I bought a big bottle of Three Olives Dude flavor.
Okay.
Which is a lemon-lime vodka. And it took me and my SO, like, 2 years to drink. And when we finished it, we fucking party. Like, we celebrated by drinking more of other things. We're like, fuck yeah, the dude is dead! Like, it was good at first. And then, like, after a certain amount of shots, we're just like, this is horrible. We're sick of this. And when we finally finished it, it was triumphant. Right?
Nice.
Ryan,
okay.
This is the Beer versus Mancast part two, or episode two, part two, the viewer mail section. And I'm drunk.
Are you drunk and drunk, dude?
I think I might be.
Fuck!
I'm gonna stop drinking for a minute.
Do I have to, like, drive this bus because you're drunk and drunk?
I'm gonna really... Well, I do not support drinking and driving at all.
It's the theoretical. It's like the... But, not theoretical. It's the metaphorical bus that we're
both
on
right
now.
I'm gonna try and drive the metaphorical bus, but I would never... Under these circumstances, I would never drive an actual bus. I don't even know how to do that sober, bro.
Oh, dude, you're right. I don't know how to drive a bus.
I would think I know how to drive a bus, and then I get into it and be like, this is not like a car.
No, you just fucking Sandra Bullock it in fucking speed, dog.
If I had to, like, I could,
yeah,
I
she
could
had
beat
to,
Keanu
and
Reeves.
You know what? Sandra Bullock is America's sweetheart, and she came to fruition.
And she looks like Joe. Like, what?
Oh, dude, you just officially introduced that into BVMC.
Yeah, I made that. I don't care.
Canon.
I don't even know if I believe that, but it's canon.
No, I believe that. Sandra Bullock looks like Skinny Joe. Done.
So, Joe, we're going to talk about Joe for, like, a second.
Okay, we can talk about Joe for a second. He might listen.
You know how some people say, like, oh, you look so much like your sibling, you look so much like your father, your mother, or whatever.
Yep.
Joe is the only person I've ever met who actually looks like their sibling of the opposite gender.
Wait, you tell me that Joe looks like his sister?
Yeah. The only person I've ever met that, like, actually looks like their sibling of the opposite gender.
Hmm. Okay. All right.
Trust me.
Sure.
Trust me.
He looks like Sandra Bullock.
That's it. Also, if you go into Joe's home at any point and you look at a picture of him when he was younger, he just looks like his brother. Like, straight up.
Fair.
Just a clone. They might be clones.
Yeah.
I don't know if we...
Yeah.
I've said too much. Okay.
You said too much. Yep.
Bear versus Mancast. Sorry.
Are you all right?
Beer versus
assistance.
No, Beer versus Mancast, episode 2, part 2, the viewer mail section.
Yep.
Let's do this.
Okay, here we go.
Okay, so I don't need you to drive this bus. What I need you to do is drink more.
Oh, all right. Well, down the hatch.
Okay, so I'm gonna. While Ryan is drinking, don't stop drinking. Don't stop.
Oh shit! I did.
Stop! Don't stop. I'm going to introduce the first question. Ryan, should we just go down these top to bottom? That's probably easier, right?
Yeah, that sounds fine. Yeah, that sounds great.
Okay. Okay. That's easier. That'll keep us on the same page here because we're reading out the same doc here. So, this is an email that we got from Carla, and she lives in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Go Steelers, am I right? Carla knows what I'm talking about. Carla knows what's up. So she says, I listened to this fun segment on another video game podcast, and I thought you guys should give it a shot, too. Describe each other's opinion of video games, and then discuss how accurate each other was. I think she might... Each other were? It's what I think she might mean. Ryan is making real-time corrections. This is the age we live in. This is 2015. This is the age of the internet. This is the the cloud.
Real-time
editing of emails. This is life, man. All right, so, Ryan, I think I need a second to potentially sober up, so I'm going to let you go first.
Oh, Christ.
Just please indulge Carla from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and tell everyone how you view my opinion. My opinion of video games. So I think she means, like, what kind of video games generally do I like?
Okay, ready? Okay, I got this.
Be as general as possible, she wants you to do.
So, okay. 3x3 on iOS, 10 out of 10, every time. Not 3x3.
3x3? I was like, what? Are you saying my 9 favorite games of all time are all iOS games? What?
Maybe.
No, not all of them.
Match the, 3 on iOS, 10 out of 10, every time.
Mm-hmm.
You, hold on. Hold your tongue.
I did. David didn't even say words.
Call of Duty is fun.
Okay.
I like Destiny when my friends play it.
Okay.
Sometimes I like Indie Darlings. The Nick Oblechick story.
That is... I didn't even tell you the name of my autobiography. How did you know? That's fucked up.
Sometimes I like Indie Darlings. Fucking, I don't know.
Get
Madden is trash.
Okay. All right. That's not.
Entirely inaccurate.
That's not. No. That's not. I wouldn't say that's wrong.
Okay. All right. What do you got? Lay it on me.
So should I tell you how I feel about what you just told me first, or should I do you?
I feel like you should give me your gut reaction to what I just said.
Okay. I missed one line. I love all match threes. Madden is trash. Destiny is fun with friends, and I like Call of Duty. Was that it?
Yeah, pretty much.
And
yeah.
Indie Darlings.
Yes, Indie Darlings.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. So here's what it is. Here's I wouldn't say anything you said is wrong. I would not... That would be extreme if I told you that what you just said was wrong.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
In no particular order, because I didn't write this down properly. I love match threes, but there is such a thing as a bullshit match three.
Like, okay. All right.
I don't do Candy Crush and that kind of stuff. Because it's okay. All fair. That free-to-play stuff that conflicts with my... I do want to love those games, but the whole life system and the whole random... Like, you get to a certain point in that game where you're just like, oh, well, you get the right pieces to win this match? Nope. Okay, well, fuck you. Pay us money.
Okay, well, fuck you.
Yeah, like, well, if you pay us money, then you get more turns or you get a... Puzzle Quest. I love Puzzle Quest.
Is Puzzle Quest your favorite game?
No, Dark Souls is. Puzzle Quest okay. is... Puzzle Quest is special to me because it has just simple, fun gameplay, but there's also more to it because it's not just about what blocks decide to appear in the field. It's more diverse than that. There's equipment and there's skills and there's more factors to it. But ultimately, I do love match threes. Now, about Call of Duty.
So you love them so much you call them matchies. So
matchies?
Is that what you just said? I thought that's what you said.
I meant to say match threes, but I'm going you to said, call them matchies from now on. Oh, see, what's happening? You said
matchies.
Right, what's happening?
And it made me laugh.
It's a phenomena. Yeah. But when someone gets drunk, they start slurring all of their words.
That's true.
And
that's
happening. And I'm very guilty of that.
Mm-hmm. Matchies might be my new favorite thing that you've ever said that I heard.
No, because one time I said, they just merged Genki, and that was your favorite thing.
That was really good.
Okay, Call of Duty.
They just merged Genki.
I really like, I in previous years, I've liked Call of Duty, but I'm becoming an old man, and I'm really bad at Call of Duty now.
And were you, like, not 2 or 3 years ago?
I wasn't good at it. I wasn't, like, great at it. I was good at it. Like, Modern Warfare 3, Black Ops 2, I was good at it.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's just, it's a lot to take in. And I appreciate a lot of things about Call of Duty. This particular year, Black Ops 3 is a very feature-rich game that I like for other reasons. But, like, when it comes down to the multiplayer and even playing with my friends, it's a lot for me to do. Like, it's hard. Like, it's so twitchy. And, like, this is fatigue that you experienced, like, 2 or 3 years ago. I remember you tried to play Modern Warfare 3, and you were just like...
I did.
You were just like, no, I can't play this game. And that was, like, potentially, like, the high point of my Call of Duty career. I really liked that game. And I was better at it than I am now. But now, your sentiments about that game are kind of how I feel about this new one, that it's, like, really inaccessible because of how twitchy and, like, hard it is to play.
Totally.
Which is weird because I would have... I'm thinking back at, like, the time I spent playing Titanfall this year with my friends, and, like, a lot of those elements are there, but I don't... It's different. I don't think of Titanfall that way because you have the robot and you become unkillable. I don't know.
I had fun with Titanfall in a way that I didn't have fun any Call of Duty.
The scale is different. The game length is different. Like, it's just different. I'm really looking forward to Titanfall 2. But Call of Duty, much as I do have a good time, even with the newest game, I do have a good time playing a couple rounds with my friends now. Sometimes, just like the other night, like, they were playing Call of Duty, I was just like, I'm too tough. Like, I can't. I don't have it in me to play this game. I have to play Call of Duty. I'm playing Fallout. Totally. I'm going to just continue playing Fallout 4, and I'm just going to talk to you guys. And that's going to be that. And
that'll have to do, I suppose.
And they were like, hey, you switching over? I'm like, nah. And they were, you know, we just kept bullshitting. Like, it was fine, because I couldn't take it. Also, I've been playing so much Fallout 4 that that's a tough transition. Like a shooting game that's super slow, where I can just, if I feel like I can stop time and just blow some dude. Like, it's...
You can, yep.
Yeah, I can just blow some dude. It's just different, and it's tough. And so what you said about how I feel about Destiny is pretty much spot on. Destiny is... You try and play Destiny by yourself, you're probably going to have a bad time. But if you have a fire team of people who are, like, dedicated to getting shit done and, like, getting good gear, it's kind of like when you have a WoW guild where you are, like...
Yeah, I can definitely see that.
When you're, like...
Definitely.
But the scale is so much different. Because all I need to do is... Xbox One, I just find two idiots who want to play Destiny with me, and I'm done. WoW, like, so when you want to play WoW with people, you had to change servers, and you had to... Make sure you're available on Sunday mornings, blah, 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 like, ordeal. Mm-hmm. But, like, it's the same sort of thing, where you actually get to know how you play with a certain group, and you play high-level stuff, and you have a good time. That I really like Destiny with friends, so that is very accurate.
Totally.
And that game is probably... That's where that game shines, as far as I'm concerned. But some of those missions don't really change when you play by yourself versus when you play with three people. So that's kind of garbage. So you play by yourself, you're going to have a bad time. Let me see. I like Indie Darling sometimes?
Yes, that's what I said.
That's pretty good. That's
yeah.
I'm not going to say I wholesale love every indie game. I'm fascinated by...
Because you don't. Yeah.
Because some indie games are just not good. Like, they don't play well, or the story is stupid. But, like, there are certain indie games that are obviously really great. And there are a lot of games that I love because they're such just unique experiences, or they're personal stories that are just fascinating to me, or they tell a different perspective, or they tell a different story that you don't see in Uncharted. That sort of thing.
Right.
A lot of things to love about indie games, but, like, yes, I love indie games sometimes is perfect because some indie games just aren't good. And
Some indie games aren't good.
I don't want to, and I don't necessarily think I can just put someone on... No, you know what? I am going to put someone on blast. There's a game.
Okay. Yep.
I'm going to get the game... I'm going to get the name of this game correct. I'm going to look it up in my Steam library. Just so everyone knows, officially, it is called Doc Clock, The Toasted Sandwich of Time. And it is a 2D side-scrolling platformer-ish puzzle game with, like, puzzle solving, and you, like, manipulate parts of the environment and things like that. That game sucks. It's terrible.
Okay.
It's not fun. Here's another game. Okay.
Not fun.
No Time to Explain, the original version of that game, was just... The physics weren't right. The game didn't play properly. It's like a platformer where you kind of have this, like, beam gun that helps you hover or manipulate your jumps in some way. But the original version of that game did not work at all. They since have fixed it and re-released it. I can't speak to it now. But, like, yeah, sometimes games by independent studios come out and are bad. But sometimes you have games by independent studios, like this game called... A free game called Norland that I'm a really big fan of, that is just kind of a fucking crazy, dumb thing that was created by Swedish people to maybe prove a point. Or, you know, you have games like Goat Simulator that just, like, stupid fun, like, and it's like works, or, like, you know, games like Her Story that I'm pretty sure that's independently published that are really effective storytelling things. Like, in a lot of ways, indie games are the future, indie darlings, but, like, some ways are just
indie
like
darlings.
Some way indie darlings are just like fucking bad games, you know what I mean? Like, they're just
totally
not, they're totally, independently, they couldn't find a publisher because they're not good, but. You know, I'm not gonna. I'm going to pass that judgment on a game-to-game basis. I heard this to kind of get away from the topic a little bit. I heard this term today called triple I. And I guess it's supposed to describe like big budget,
quote, I'm already disgusted,
indie games. I never heard this term before today, and I was just like, I don't. I hope I never hear that term again.
Yeah, no, that sounds gross.
I'm not even sure what they mean by it. Like, I guess you can. Some games get kind of a rap as being, quote, indie, completely dependent of whether or not they were published by a company or they were published by the developer.
Yeah.
And that's funny to me. Like low budget game, like a 2D game, gets called an indie title, even though it's developed by. So, like, what comes to light is, what comes to mind is Child of Light.
Mm-hmm.
It's like not a full budget in comparison to something like Metal Gear Solid V or something like that, but like.
Right.
It's a full-ish budget game that's 2D by Ubisoft, who is a accomplished developer, but it's not really a triple-A game. So I guess that would be a game that's like triple-I, but also I have a secret. You want to hear a secret?
Yes, I do.
Child of Light is garbage.
Child of Light's a bad game.
I don't like it at all, and I tried so hard to like it, Ryan.
You tried way harder than I did.
Oh, yeah, way harder. I played that at PAX East 2014.
Yeah.
Are we going to PAX next year?
We are.
We need to
make buttons.
We need a plan. I know, shut up. Okay, I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you about how you feel about games. Are you ready?
Because yeah, tell me.
Carla from Pittsburgh has been waiting for this forever, and we're at the first question, and we've been doing this for, like, 20 minutes.
We're doing well.
We have, like, many more questions to get through.
Okay. Yes. Yes.
All right, give me a second.
Okay, I'm giving you a second.
So, Ryan's opinion of games. Turn-based games rule.
Mm-hmm.
You also really like tactics games.
Mm-hmm.
Shooters are hard.
Okay.
Refute that. Like, okay, hold on. I'm gonna get through this. I'm gonna get through this before you get your... Okay. Stories are lame. And okay. I'm gonna do just one more. Let's say, how do you feel about video games? I hate WoW.
Oh, shit.
That's it. I got it. Nailed it.
Fuck.
The judges off the side of the ice skating rink are giving me got 9, got 10, I got 9. Nailed it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you did gift. Gift. You did good.
What? Oh, man. Are you drunk, too?
A little bit.
Oh, we're
I definitely right didn't. I've been drinking since about 1:45.
Oh, word. I started at, like, 4.
Yeah. Turn-based games are good. That's true.
Mm-hmm.
I do like tactics games. This is also true. Shooters are hard. Can't deny that.
Yeah, you don't... You just... Because I'm not going to say that, like, you don't like shooters, but I feel like most
but
shooters...
But they are hard.
Most shooters you walk away from going, like... Well, that was hard. Like, that was, like, inaccessible to me in some way. Yes. But I didn't like... You're like, I didn't dislike it, but I
like shooters, but I am bad.
Like, I'd say more like... I think a better way for me to say that was, like, I find shooters inaccessible in some way.
Yes, that's 100% accurate. Because
you're like, oh, shit, that game's cool, but, like, I can't play it for X, Y, or Z.
Yes, yeah, I can't play that because I can't play that.
I don't know what else I said.
You said, I hate WoW. Not true, but also, as the days go on since the last time I played WoW to now, I have a fading and waning interest in it.
Yeah, it's been bad lately. You really don't give a shit about that game.
It's more that, like, this expansion I was so incredibly disappointed in.
After being so hyped for it, too.
Yeah, I was just... I felt really let down by it. But we don't have to get into it right now.
There'll be time for that
later.
What was the other... I said one other thing.
Oh, you did.
Shooters are hard. Oh, I don't give a shit about stories.
I don't. That's accurate.
Which is quite amazing. Like, you liked her story.
Weird,
like,
right?
You said, like...
Fucking weird.
You're like, I'd like her story. And I looked around my apartment like, is fucking Ashton Kutcher here? Have I been punked? Like, what the
Yo, where's this motherfucker Ashton Kutcher at? You gonna tell me
that
I was
like, yo, special
right
guest
now?
On the Bears' main cast, Ashton Kutcher. Yeah, because you just don't...
I just don't care.
You don't care. Like, well, like, what about The Witcher 3? Do you care about that story? Or are you just like, I like hitting stuff with swords?
No, So the story in that game is fine. I like the characters in that game. If that makes any sense.
Yeah, that,
like,
actually makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I don't particularly care for, like, the big old through line, because I actually think it's wicked lame. But I like the characters that are introduced to you as you play the game.
Yeah, that does make sense. Like, that's actually, like, really interesting, because characters can be really endearing in a way that, you know, I think we talked about Persona extensively in the first part of the Beard vs. Mancast episode 2. And
yes,
the characters are, like, the best part of that entire game. It's like, you just, like,
yeah,
I want to give a shit about this character. Like, you're like, look at, like, Persona 4, like, you look at Kanji Tatsume, and you're just like, his story is weird, but just like, I fucking want to give a shit about this guy,
like,
for some reason. I don't know.
I like Kanji. Kanji's cool.
And you're like, oh, okay, so he's got some weird gay thing going on. Like, tell me more about this dude. Like, this is interesting. But the story itself, you're just like, eh. I'm trying to think of, like, a story-based game that I try to get you to play, and you're just like, no, this is stupid. And I can't... There are so many, I'm just at a loss. Like...
Yeah, I don't know.
But in general, like, story-based games, you just don't... You know, like, you wouldn't play, like, a Twine game or, like, any really, like, point-and-click adventure game. You just don't...
I hate adventure games.
You're just, like, there's no game...
Full-barred, like, hate adventure games.
Because the gameplay's not there, so you just don't see the point. And
the gameplay is, like, negative not there, in that, like, a lot of times old school adventure games are like, put this on this until it works, and I'm like, I don't want to.
Yeah, so yes, if an adventure game is like that, then it has bigger problems. That if the solutions are not clear, in my opinion, that's bad game design, and that's not just being an adventure game, that's bad game design, if you really are just resorting to using everything on everything. But I get your point. Like, if the gameplay is not... I've played plenty of games that have no gameplay that I just wanted to see it through the end of the story, and
yeah, totally.
You will not stand for that.
I will not. No.
And you... Yeah. No, that's fine. That is perfectly fine. I will not judge you for that. Because I don't... Sometimes I play games, I play through the story, I play for the story, and I go, like, why am I playing this? I mean, it might as well just be a book. I like the Phoenix Wright games.
Yeah, don't want to play those.
The gameplay in those are super mild. God, I love those games. Holy shit, they're so good. Okay, I think it's time for question two. That it's amazing that we're only on question two. But I want you to know that I'm proud of you guys because you sent us a collection, a wide variety of emails. Some are about video games, some not so much. And so we're gonna try and break it up a little bit. We're gonna try and a little roller coaster ride here. So, Ryan, I'm gonna let you take this one. You read this one.
All right. I need the Bears' help concluding an eternal debate. Hot dog buns, steamed or toasted? Gregory from Grand Rapids, Michigan.
I'll let you answer first.
Are we talking? What kind of hot dog buns are we talking about here? Are we talking about New England style buns?
I'll talk to you
about New England style buns.
That's the correct all day, Ryan. That is the correct answer. That is fucking killing it. All right.
There are two kinds of hot dog buns. There are New England style, and there are not New England style.
Okay, so there's two types of hot dog buns. There's New England style buns and fucking garbage.
And then there's the shit you throw in the trash when you're fucking when your buddy's like, "Hey, I brought hot dog buns," and he's like, "What
and
the fuck
like,
is
get
this
the
shit?
Fuck out of my house." That's what
go
you
back
say to them.
And go to the store and get me the right hot dog buns, the one that say, "I'm from New England, and fuck you."
So now that we've established that Coney Island-style buns are fucking garbage, we can proceed with this question. New England-style buns, steamed or toasted?
Toasted every time.
Toasted every time. Although, every time. My version of toasted is more like griddled.
Yeah, you slather that shit in melted butter, and you put it on a griddle.
If you have a flat top or an equivalent... Damn, son. But, like, if you're making it on, like, an actual, like, grill, that'll work, too.
I don't think it would.
It's better than steamed in that situation.
Who steams a hot dog bun?
Like,
that's
fucking
my question.
New York pieces of shit. Like, I don't know. Like, fucking... Okay, so I do have to say, okay. Have you ever had a Nathan's hot dog?
No, I don't think so.
Nathan's hot dogs. It's a New England institution. They make a damn fine all-beef hot dog.
Okay,
maybe my favorite hot dogs. But you're going to get New England-style buns, and if you're not New England-style, Coney Island-style. And if you're using the Coney Island-style, you know, it's not a lot of open-faced bread to toast. So, like, maybe you're better off steaming it. But, like, you know, like, if you're just getting, like a dirty water dog... On the like a
dirty water dog.
You're not familiar with that concept?
I'm very familiar.
Because
yeah.
Sometimes I like a good old fashioned like boiled hot dog, and like I can see how sometimes you might, you know, have them steamed, but like at the end of the day, it's all about that griddled man, like having a little crunch with your. Yes, that is what you need. Mm-hmm. That being said,
I want that.
That being said, hot dogs are gross and not good for you.
I know. I like hot dogs.
I like hot dogs, but they're gross and not good for you. I love hot dogs, but they're gross and not good for you.
Yes, that's fine. But I accept this.
Gregory, what you need to understand, New England style bun.
New England style bun. Just in case you don't know, it's the one that's like it kind of looks like an entire loaf of bread with divots in it, and then you like peel them apart, and there's like white on the inside.
There's just bread on both sides. If you live in a state where you cannot get New England style buns, consider moving.
Okay. If you live in a state where you can't get New England style buns, take a piece of Wonder Bread and fold it in half.
Yep.
It's a relative approximation.
Close enough. I'm going to consider moving, unless you live in, like, Southern California or, like...
I can confirm you can get New England-style hot dog buns at least
Southern
in San Diego.
Southern California is perfect, man. That place is great. Get In-N-Out, New England-style buns. There's, like, a bunch of good breweries. The weather is great. That place fucking rules. Okay.
All right.
Great question, Gregory. You're killing it. Killing it, bro. Okay. Can I go? Can we take like a super fast break?
Yes, I need to do that.
Okay, it's going to be the super fast. Like, you guys aren't even going to like realize how fast this break is. It's going to be that fast.
All right, ready? Go. Ugh. Why does fucking beer just like flow through my body?
Because alcohol is a diuretic. Just like coffee. It's like the main two things that you and I drink now, so.
Coffee and beer. Let's do it. All right, I'm ready.
Robert from Kansas City, Kansas asks, you idiots talk about... All right, sorry.
Hold the phone, Roberto.
You're rude, is why I pronounced your name incorrectly. Your name is Roberto.
Fact.
And you're rude. You idiots talk about all sorts of things that aren't video games, sandwiches, movies, etc. Guilty. But you don't talk much about music. You guys tell me a little bit about what kinds of music you guys don't think sucks. It's a good question. Good way to phrase it. I don't know, you want to answer that question, Ryan?
I realistically don't listen to that much music anymore.
It's a funny thing about knowing Ryan for a long time is I always thought of him as like a music person.
That's fair considering my colored past.
It's just people thought of you, and like if you didn't know Ryan, you'd call him a music person. But like really, he just listened to John Mayer and like maybe some jazz, and then like whatever. And some people, I've met people who have said that like they're just like, if I was told that I could never listen to music again, I'd be fine with it. And I was like, what? No, that'd be terrible. I need music.
I'm that guy.
Really?
Yes.
That is so unlike people's stereotypical view of Ryan.
If someone told me tomorrow that I could never listen to music again, I'd be like, okay.
That would be so
fine.
Upsetting.
Like, people, I work with a lot of people who are, like, really music people. Like, they know every band that they're into, and they know all the members, and they're just like, this guy played with this guy on this thing at this time and this place and blah, blah, blah. And they're like, listen to this fucking underground band that I think is wicked dope. And I'm just like, what? I don't care.
This is shit.
It's all fucking, it's music. It sounds the same. Who cares? Oh, it's bad. But yeah, I don't know. I really like the One-Ups. One-Ups are good.
They're good. They play. Good. They play like jazz versions of classic, like 8 and 16 bit game music.
They've spread out a little bit more.
Like to like and now PS1 they just kinda... and like that kind of stuff. Like,
I think they have some like Resident Evil tracks from like RE4 and stuff that they've covered.
Are you familiar at all with the video game orchestra's work?
Not really, but
they're pretty good. They did a cover of a song from Silent Hill 2. That I'm not really familiar with the music in those games, so like I thought it was gonna be really like, ooh, it's gonna be a spoopy song, it's gonna be so scary. And I heard it, and it was just like fucking jazzy as fuck, and I was like, yes, oh yeah. Theme of Laura, is the name of the track. VGO did it, and it's really good. But like, besides video game music. Like, I mean, like we talked about video game music. Like this game has good music. This game has bad music. We were just talking about Persona and like music, video game music. This and you know whatever. Shoji Meguro that.
Yeah.
But like you don't. Like if you're just like driving, like you just listen to podcasts in the car all the time. Like that's it.
I do. Yeah.
I listen. I guess I do the
podcasts.
Same when I can. But like if I run out, I'll listen to music. I like music.
Music's fine.
Do I know?
I guess.
Do you know what kind of music I think doesn't suck?
What kind?
Oh, it's complicated.
Oh, okay.
Next question. No. I have really interesting tastes in music. I care about... So, I listen to a wide variety of things, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. There's some hip-hop I listen to. Especially, it's something I got from college, that if I'm drinking, sometimes I just need to listen to hip-hop music. It's just...
Okay,
it's
sure.
It's a... Like a Pavlovian response that I developed from college.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But besides that, I like all sorts of rock, specifically either metal or alternative. I also like lots of video game music that I listen to when I'm not playing the games, which might make me a crazy person. There's a couple different like indie game soundtracks that I would listen to just to kind of like chill out or whatever, as opposed to like actually listening to them as a facet of the game. There's a lot of classic video game music like that too that I like, but I won't, you know, like the soundtrack from Sonic the Hedgehog 3 is good, but I probably wouldn't listen to it just by itself for no reason. But besides that, okay. I've, especially lately, been listening to a lot of EDM. Like,
what?
A lot of electronic dance music, which is like the vaguest umbrella of all music. So,
yeah, no, that's true.
It's like all sorts of like actual, like, I don't listen to dubstep so much, but like, actual like dance music in addition to some like trance and some trap. Like,
I don't know what any of that means. So
trance is, it's a, you know, it's all like generally falls in the category of like techno is everything I'm talking about. Okay. Which is really, techno is a reductive way to talk about it, but like, I like Daft Punk a lot. Daft Punk's really
good. Daft Punk's pretty good.
They're kind of the progenitors of modern like electronic music, but like you have like dance style music. Trap music is a little bit like, trap music is like a cultural thing, but it's like a little bit more rappy, a little bit bassier, a little bit more drums. Like, I once read a really descriptive definition of what trap music is, and I can't possibly repeat it, like recall it and repeat it here, but like,
mm-hmm.
it's got some hip-hop inspiration for sure. Apparently trap music is based on like a trap, or like a trap house is like a place that people go to do drugs, or like people, place that people make drugs. So it's got like this, it's born from something weird and cultural, but it's something very unique. You know, but trance music's a little bit more out there. I'll just throw like an EDM station on Pandora and just like nod my head to it while I'm playing video games. You know?
Yeah. Okay.
Like, I don't know. Like, it's just, I don't even care. Like, it doesn't even be specific. There's a couple tracks that in particular that I think are like super hot, but. Yeah, I mean, like rock, alternative rock. Depends on my mood. Listen to some hip-hop, listen to some EDM. Like, I like metal in a fair amount. I won't just listen to, like, screamo garbage, but something like All That Remains that's, like, a little bit more melodic. Or,
sure.
Rise Against that is admittedly very punk as well. They're, like, kind of punk, straight on that line of metal. They're really good. But I also listen to a lot of indie rock. Two Door Cinema Club, your boy, or like Matt and Kim.
I have that,
or
you guys often request that radio station.
You put that on during Family Geek Board Game Night without us even asking anymore. You just put that on. Like, that's the theme of Board Game Night. And that's a good,
that's the, yeah.
Like, it's like Two Door Cinema Club is just like a chill band, a couple guys playing guitar and singing, like, not like acoustic jam weird stuff, but like, it's like a, they're making like chill rock music that's like all right to listen to in the background. I don't know. I listen to a really wide variety of things, and I also don't like to subject the people I don't know to my music opinions. Like,
okay, yep.
If you're someone, you're like a member of my family, or someone who has decided that they are somehow, they have to put up with my bullshit, anything goes. But if you're just like, oh, hey, guy I work with, I'm not going to necessarily make you listen to the shit I listen to. You know what I mean?
I do, yeah. But like,
it's a wide variety of stuff. Next question.
Okay, yep.
I might come back to this. Probably not. Next question.
Yep. Am I reading it?
Yes.
Oh. I think you may have mentioned this on a previous podcast.
I forgot something really important.
What?
About the last question, about music.
Okay, yep.
There's a particular singer-songwriter from the United Kingdom. Her name is Ellie Goulding.
Do you have a love confession for her?
My fucking wife. All right? Remember that time that we were in San Diego and lights came on the radio and you were like, oh, this shit's gay, I'm going to change it. And I was like, no. Leave it.
No, like, really, she's my wife.
Leave it. Got tickets to go see her next year. I don't even know when. I just bought the tickets. The details are not important. Give me the tickets. She's amazing. She does like a little bit. The best way to describe her music is electro folk. She's got it's a little bit electronic, but she got the voice of an angel. She's got some folk roots. She's a traditional singer, but like, okay. Actual next question.
Yes. I think you may have mentioned this on a previous podcast, but I think it's an important issue worth taking the time to discuss. Do different pasta shapes taste different? And if you're like me and you think that they do, what is the best tasting pasta shape? Brick in San Francisco, California. Let me tell you something, Brick.
Yes.
Best tasting pasta shape is farfalle.
Yes! Yes!
AKA
yes!
bow ties.
Yes, you're absolutely correct. Next question. No.
AKA bow ties.
Bow ties. I believe that every pasta shape, almost every pasta shape, has its place. But bow ties are probably the best.
Best pasta shape, bow ties. Second best pasta shape, probably a tie between penne and wheels.
I haven't had a good wagon wheel in like an ill minute, dude. How do you feel about rotini?
Rotini, great pasta shape.
I like rotini a lot.
8 out of 10.
What's the worst pasta shape?
The penne without the ridges.
Ziti? Or, no, penne, or what do they call that? They call it penne without the ridges.
Skinny.
That's what they call it.
It's like wicked
skinny.
How
do you feel about, you know what cavatappi is?
Is that is it the one that's like an elbow, but they forgot to turn the machine off?
Dude, that's exactly that's literally exactly how I was gonna describe it if you didn't know what it was. That's exactly what it is.
Yeah, that's a fucking that's an 8 out of 10 pasta shape.
I hate that shape, dude.
No, that's, I like that
that's
shape.
That's a fucking pasta shape for jabronis. That's like...
No, you're wrong.
If you're like a dumbass motherfucker who doesn't know how to make food, you just use that. You're like, I don't know. I made mac and cheese. I put bacon in it, and I use this shape. I don't even know. Like, what am I doing? Who am I? Where am I?
Oh, no. I think you're wrong.
I hate that shape. Because here's the problem with that shape. It's too big. You get like a plate of cavatappi, and you take 8 bites, and it's over. You take 8 pieces of pasta, it's done.
I like it.
So what's the worst pasta shape then?
It's the ziti with the knot with there's really, no ridges.
I think it's just called ziti.
Well, then ZD. ZD's the worst pasta shape. Penne. Okay. Penne's here. It's here to stay.
I have a nostalgic love for ZD, but
okay, that's fine.
Yeah, I can see how it's not maybe not all there. But Farfalle just.
Dude, fucking Farfalle, dude.
Dude, nothing else matters. Farfalle.
10 out of 10 bow ties.
Think about mini ZD. Like, smaller, like, less large hole ZD.
No, that's even worse.
Ethan's got the lines?
A little better, but it's still bad.
How do you feel about thick spaghetti?
I'm upset, Nick.
Yeah, because you think spaghetti by itself is too thick.
Spaghetti is the second worst pasta shape.
Wow. Really?
Yeah.
You like linguine and fettuccine and thin spaghetti, but just spaghetti is terrible and thick spaghetti is even worse?
Yep. Nope, that's all accurate. All those words you just said are very true. All
right, well, I think that we're on the same page here, so we can move on to the next question.
Yeah, okay.
So this is a question about video game music.
Uh-oh.
It comes from Bart, and he lives in Denver, Colorado.
Okay, yep.
And so saith Bart, Bear and Man, I was hoping you guys could discuss the subject of video game music. In video game music, is video game music only good only in the game that it's from? Or is there such a thing as VGM that's good enough to listen to by itself? Could you share with us some of your favorite video game songs / soundtracks? And he has a couple different difficulty modes for us to share our soundtracks with. So
okay.
We're going to go through it step at a time here. I do think that there is such a thing as video game music that's good enough to listen to by itself, as I discussed earlier. But
I do as well.
Just enjoying it as music is... You know, like, it's what comes to mind is the soundtrack for Dust Force is just a super calming, peaceful, good soundtrack. And there's also...
Are you...
What?
Yep.
Like, that's just a good soundtrack.
I was just going to say, I can do Tournament 7 mode.
Okay. So, hard mode is no first-party Nintendo games, which, that's... Makes it a little more challenging. That rules out, like, well, I guess Chrono Trigger's not a first-party Nintendo game.
It's not.
Chrono Trigger's got a good-ass soundtrack, though.
Chrono Trigger, great soundtrack.
But, like, you know, like, that great rules out, like, Ocarina of Time and Link to the Past and, you know,
Earthbound.
Yes. I mean, there aren't a lot of first-party Nintendo games that I would listen to with music by themselves, but there's a lot of first-party Nintendo games that have good music for the context of the game. Earthbound being definitely among them. And there's Nightmare Mode, which is no 8 or 16-bit games.
Yep.
Which does complicate things. Makes you want to say things like, you know, Banjo-Kazooie, but I don't think the music in Banjo-Kazooie is, like, that good. But it does make me think of, like, you know, like Super Meat Boy.
Every Mega Man game.
Oh, Mega Man 2 in particular is my favorite.
Dude.
But, like, it makes me think of, like, Super Meat Boy, and a lot of other indie games that have come, what's the other one I'm thinking of? Crypt of the NecroDancer has really good music. The list of titles goes on and on. Risk of Rain has a good soundtrack.
Yeah, it does.
Luftrausers. That's a solid soundtrack.
Luftrausers got a great soundtrack.
I know you don't want the soundtrack for Thomas Was Alone, but I think it's solid.
I think Thomas Was Alone is a bad game.
I know. Space Cam has a cool soundtrack.
Space Cam has a dope soundtrack.
And I mean, that's all that comes to mind at the moment. I'm just kind of scrolling through my playlist of VGM here. But, like, there are definitely more modern... Maybe independent.
Tournament 7 mode, are you ready?
Torment 7 mode. No indie games. So no first-party Nintendo games. No 8 or 16-bit games. No indie games. Persona.
Dog, are you ready?
Persona is the only...
It's only Persona. It's the only answer. Yeah.
It's like, I don't know, Final Fantasy 7 or later was okay, I get.
Final Fantasy 9 has a great soundtrack.
You love Final Fantasy 9.
It's my favorite Final Fantasy, motherfucker.
Yeah, you're wrong.
Whoa. Yeah, it's Persona. But just my favorites are Ori and the Blind Forest has a great soundtrack. Bastion has a great soundtrack.
Oh, fucking Bastion.
Bastion has a fantastic soundtrack.
I love Bastion.
Yep.
I love that. Bastion is a video game soundtrack. Certain tracks on that game send shivers through my body. Mm. It's so good. Although, then again, Persona 3 has at least one track that does the same thing to me. So,
Undertale, great soundtrack.
I've heard that.
Undertale is a great soundtrack.
I should think about playing that game.
You should fucking play that game.
Persona.
What's that
Persona,
fucking? Persona, what's Persona. That song?
Persona. What do you think about Persona?
Nope. It's like
Is it an indie game?
My favorite Undertale track is Bergentrucken.
Okay. All right.
It's very good.
Okay. I would never play that game and not be able to ever recognize that, but... I mean, actually, you know what? I think I have somewhere... The Undertale soundtrack is, like, on...
It's on YouTube.
It's also on Bandcamp.
The fuck is Bandcamp?
You can, like, buy it and whatever, because, like, the guy who made the game just made the soundtrack and just, like, put it out there.
Oh, dope. Yeah, so those are my favorites. Yeah.
Is the, yeah, I think I hit all my favorites. Oh, this is cool.
Yeah. But that's definitely my favorite one.
This is pretty all right, man.
Yep.
That's a lot of, I can't even think. As we've discussed in previous Beer versus Man episodes, the first thing that goes when I start drinking is my memory. So, there's a lot of things I'm forgetting, but there's really a lot of... I'm so glad you mentioned Bastion, because that shit is so hot.
Bastion soundtrack is fucking really good.
That shit is so hot. That game... Bastion is, like, seriously as close to a perfect game as we're going to ever get, possibly.
Ooh, wow.
The soundtrack is great. The story is great. The gameplay is fun. It's not too long. It's not too short. Like, it's incredible.
All right.
I had to say that. That needed to be said. My foot is really asleep.
Okay.
And this song is really good. Bergentrucken? Is that really how you good. Say that? It looks like Bergen Trucking.
It's Bergen Trucking.
Okay. All right. You're
very
more,
good.
You're like more German than I am, so.
That's true. I am.
We got a question from Twitter this time.
All right.
It's your turn, so. I'm just going to drink
this. If you guys had sandwiches named after you, what would they be? At Lil's Meg. Is that, like, what would the sandwiches be called, or what would be in the sandwiches?
I think he means what would be in the sandwiches. Like, what?
All right.
Like, it's like, have you ever been to a legit... This song you sent me is 15 minutes long, Ryan.
Well, it's like a battle theme from a boss fight, so it kind of just, like, that guy put it on loop.
Wow, thanks, guy. Have you ever been to a sandwich place that... Are you familiar with, like, the stereotype of sandwich place that has, like, a bunch of named sandwiches that are very specific bread and sauce and cheese and meat?
Like, not particularly.
You're not familiar with that, like, trope of, like, you go to a place and it's like, this is called the Elvis Costello, and it's got this bread and this meat and this cheese and this sauce and this topping.
I don't think so.
Because I went to a real-life one of those. It's called Chef's Superlative Sandwiches, and it's in Providence, Rhode Island. And they have just chalkboards on either side of the restaurant that just have named sandwiches with it's on, you know, as I described, like detailed out for you. And you go up to the counter and you say, hey, I want this sandwich. And the person's like, okay, I'm going to make this for you. And you say, yeah, yep. But like, no, but change the cheese. And they're like, okay. And you're having a one-to-one conversation with the person. And if they say like, oh, wait, hey, what kind of cheese was that you wanted? Like, they just ask you instead of like looking at a screen or looking at a receipt or like, you know, whatever. And then you get to the counter.
They're making real ass sandwiches for real ass Jews.
Right. Is what you're and then saying. You make your sandwich, they wrap it up and they give it to you. And then you get to the counter, you get to the register. And the register, every time I went there, was run by Jeff himself of Jeff Superlative Sandwich fame. And he's a hilarious dude. And it's just like a genuine, like, real awesome place to eat. But it's got that whole, like, vibe of, you know, like, the first sandwich I ever got there was called the Kevorkian. That's like a spicy... Mm-hmm. Spicy like pastrami sandwich, but it's got like, you know, like even like the, you know, like the Reuben sandwich is a very particular kind of sandwich that's like named. So like if you went into a restaurant that you loved, like a sandwich place that you loved, and they had a the Ryan, what would that sandwich be that you'd want like other people to come in and order the Ryan, and what would you want them to experience after that happened?
All right, are you ready?
I
know exactly what I want.
I'm so ready.
Okay. All right. Ready? Hoagie roll.
Okay.
Roast beef.
Roast beef. Not
roast beef.
Not corned beef. Not pastrami. Roast beef.
Roast beef.
Okay.
Roast beef.
Okay.
Not Italian style roast beef.
Just roast good beef, old roast fashioned beef. Roast beef. Not roast French beef. Dip. Not like just. Just roasted beef. What kind of beef are we talking
roasted,
about?
Roasted top round, probably.
Okay. All right. I'm following this.
All right. Roast beef. Sliced white onion.
Yes.
Super, super thin.
Yes.
Like read a newspaper through it thin.
Yes.
But like a shitload of it.
Yes.
Some kind of lettuce-like structure.
Okay.
Okay. Red wine vinegar.
Okay. Okay.
Olive oil.
Okay.
Salt, pepper.
Definitely.
Oregano.
All right. Is that it?
A ass load of oregano. And that's it. That's the
dude,
sandwich.
That's great.
Fine.
That is simplicity incarnate.
Optional provolone.
Okay.
But it can go either way.
I don't want the provolone. I don't do provolone. Well, I don't eat a lot of cheese in general, but if I did, it wouldn't be provolone.
You don't like cheese, dude?
I don't. I just don't eat a lot of it. I think I might be lactose intolerant.
Oh, dude, that's a big bummer.
And so I just like avoid it when I don't have to eat it. Mm-hmm. So if provolone was optional, I'd be like, nah.
No cheese.
Plus, I really like the combination. If I'm gonna have beef, I really like a good white cheddar with that. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know what it is about beef and white cheddar, but so I think we may have talked about sandwiches last time we did this bonus episode.
We frequently talk about sandwiches. It comes up often.
I may have described the best sandwich I've ever made, and I would love to my I've been drinking. I apologize. Love for this sandwich to be named after me if it's ever recreated, but it was, and it will be. So the bread was it's a potato bread. It was a crusty potato bread sliced, and it was made with garlic and onion and also had, like, caraway seeds on top. So, like, a little bit evocative of, like, a rye bread, but without being a rye bread.
Okay.
And then it had sautéed onions.
Mm-hmm.
Kielbasa.
Okay.
Like a Polish style. And... so it's a grilled sandwich.
Okay.
So, like, a griddled sandwich, like a grilled cheese. This bread...
Mm-hmm.
Sauteed onions, either I mean, I like a good white cheddar, as I said. Or possibly American, if you're into that. And then I want to say it was like a Dijon mustard.
That sounds pretty sick.
Not too much, because mustard and kielbasa, I mean, you take any force meat made with pork, and you throw a little...
Spread mustard on
it. Dude, you gotta get some mustard. You gotta get Dijon mustard, whole grain mustard, even yellow mustard. I don't even care. Get some mustard on that force meat with pork. So yeah, it's just pretty simple. Sauteed onions. That bread, which is negotiable, but you get the weird potato, onion, garlic bread. Cheese, a little bit of mustard. Grill that up. Melt the cheese. Delicious. I also feel a need, now that we've talked about yellow mustard, I want to talk about what is supposed to be on a hot dog. We talked about the buns.
I will tell you.
I want you to tell me, because I have a very particular idea of what I need on my hot dog.
Mustard and relish.
Oh, yes! Oh, my God, yes! Oh, yes!
Optional diced onion.
Mm-hmm.
But...
Honestly,
sometimes I'm too lazy for that.
Yeah, no, so. you have relish in the fridge. You don't have diced onion. And to be honest with you, like, it needs to have yellow mustard. It needs to have relish. I like dill relish as opposed to sweet relish.
I like sweet relish.
That's fine.
I'm not opposed to dill relish, but I just
Sweet relish. I prefer dill relish. But you gotta have relish, or like honestly, like the Chicago style of like putting a whole pickle on your hot dog. Or, like, a pickle spear on it.
I want to do that. That sounds great.
Yeah, like, get pickle on that hot dog any way, by any means necessary. Get pickle on the hot dog. That's what I'm saying.
I want to do that. I'm going to make a hot dog relatively soon and put an entire pickle spear on it.
The Chicago-style dog is kind of a weird thing that I don't know if I can necessarily personally endorse, but it's, like, a poppy seed bun, sliced tomatoes, a pickle spear... white onion, and, like, pepperoncini. Which, I bet there's nothing wrong with that, but I never had it.
I've never had it, so
I can't necessarily... But it's also, a poppy seed bun is not New England style, so you gotta immediately throw it in the bin.
That's true.
But, like, a hot dog with mustard, relish, as long as you got that, you can do whatever you want at that point. You can even put ketchup on it. I'm not gonna really get mad.
I'm not a ketchup on a hot dog guy.
I'm not necessarily either. I think certain ketchups, or certain hot dogs, rather, can benefit from a little ketchup. But, like, if you're having a good hot dog, like I said before, I like Nathan's hot dogs. Having a good hot dog, you don't want to fuck it up too much. You just want to put a little bit of mustard, a little bit of relish, toasted bun, and just enjoy it, man. Like, don't... I'm sure Chicago dog is great, but, like... Sometimes it's a little bit too busy.
Yeah, it's got like fucking look at all that shit.
Also, that being said, my sandwich, my kielbasa sandwich or whatever. I work in a chain restaurant. We specialize partially in sandwiches, and I've discovered that myself, in addition to all the other people who work there, we have an unspoken signature sandwich. Like, there's, like, a sandwich that I just see people make all the time that's, like, bro, that's your sandwich. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just, like, oh, yeah, turkey with bacon, cheese, and barbecue sauce. Like, yeah, that's a bomb.
You own that,
like,
dude.
That's the bomb right there is what that is. And, like, I have a sandwich there that's, like, delicious. But it's not, I don't, like you said before, like, sandwiches I eat at work are not real sandwiches. So I would want the Nick to be that kielbasa sandwich with onions and cheese and mustard. Like
that sounds hella dope.
Oh, I love a good kielbasa. Honestly, like I said before, man, force meats made with pork.
Mustard.
Delicious. It was just like delicious.
Also a pickle.
Yeah. And like, oh man, give me a good salami. Like a peppered salami.
Mustard and pickle.
Delicious. Yes, every always. Time. Next question. Here we go. It's a very vague one. that I'm not even sure we can discuss, but they want us to talk about how we feel about the newest hit in rhythm games, the newest conflict, I guess you could say, about Rock Band 4 versus Guitar Hero Live.
I haven't played Guitar Hero Live.
I haven't either, but it fascinates me.
Mm.
Because I kind of yearn for that time where I didn't know how to play Guitar Hero.
That was a neat time to be alive.
Do you remember that time when you played Guitar Hero for the first time and you're just like, what the fuck is this?
I do, vaguely,
yeah. I feel like if I gave you a Guitar Hero Live controller, you would experience the exact same thing.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah.
So, like, in a lot of ways, I kind of am fascinated by Guitar Hero Live because that is a...
I almost bought it when it was, like, Black Friday sale for, like, $80.
It was, like, it was less. It was, like, 50 or 60. Like, I considered it, too. Because, like, I'm fascinated by experiencing that again about not knowing how to play the game and then, like, learning how to play it and getting into it and then playing an expert and enjoying it. That was a really cool period of discovery that maybe it just hit me in the right time of my life, that I understood it better. Like, I feel like people who were like older than us, who were like full grown people when those games came out, it just went right over their heads, and I can get that.
Yeah, they were probably just like, "What is this fucking plastic instrument garbage?"
Yeah, and I can get that for sure. But about the age we were at, like in high school, when Guitar Hero 1 came out. And, like, not having any idea what we're doing, and then slowly learning and slowly playing on expert and getting to the point where we're just like, if we don't play on expert, it's a boring piece of garbage. That's incredible. Like, that's a really unique, interesting experience that I've had in my life. And if Guitar Hero Live with this new 6-button configuration can, like, change that, it can, like, recreate that even a little bit, that's fascinating to me. Also, supposedly, it plays a little bit more like an actual guitar.
I could see that with the button structure.
Because if you have to do top of one, bottom of two, top of three, you're doing a little bit more like a chord. I mean, you certainly know more about playing the guitar than I do, but...
I do, yeah. It's like the... I could see that with the whole, you know, top on bottom button.
Yeah, like kind of, just having to arrange your fingers in not just straight line 1, 2, 1, 2, 4. Yeah. Like actually, like thinking more about where they are. You know, like generally like the positions you put your actual hand in are more like playing a guitar. I think it's really interesting. And, like, the way they do the Guitar Hero Live model of there being, like, stations that you can just kind of play along with or buy plays to play a particular song. It's fascinating, but, like, you know, I didn't buy Rock Band 4, and I have no regrets about that because I don't think I really play it that much, honestly.
That patch comes out pretty soon.
Yeah, there's some big stuff happening in Rock Band 4, and you know I'll go over your place and figure it out. Like have a good time playing it, but like
I do have that like extra copy of Rock Band 4.
Oh, I forgot about that.
If you ever just want it, I will give it to you.
I have to go get a dongle and.
Yep.
Don't tempt me. I'm my inhibitions are reduced. Don't tempt me. In a lot of ways. Rock Band 4 is the game that we've grown to love. It's more Guitar Hero, it's more Rock Band that we already know how to play and we already know that we like. But in a lot of ways, as you discussed in your review, it's a step backwards, too. So
it is, yeah.
I kind of start thinking, like, do I want to just say, like, I'll play Rock Band at Ryan's house and then just play Guitar Hero... Like, get Guitar Hero and try something new, because I don't necessarily want this better but more shitty version of Rock Band 4.
Yeah, it's, totally. Totally.
Like, Rock Band, I have a vision in my mind of what Rock Band is, and Rock Band 4 improves on it in some ways, and shits on it in other ways.
Mm-hmm.
Did the hitching ever stop?
No, not yet, but I'm sincerely hoping with that patch that comes out.
I feel like it's soon. I feel like I don't notice it all the time. Like, it's intermittent. You know, one time you played it was really bad.
I played it the other day, and it's still the same.
The beginning of Extra Life, I feel like it was a little bit, and then at the end of Extra Life, there's virtually none. It's really weird and inconsistent, but
very inconsistent.
For all I know, that shit happens in Guitar Hero 3, but or Guitar Hero Live, but
it may.
I don't know. I think Guitar Hero Live is a fascinating idea, and I'm glad that they went for it. But the fact that they're selling the game and the controller for $60 on Black Friday is like raises concerns.
Sort of telling.
It either says to me that the game was not popular enough, or that they just want to get that game in households, so people will go in there and buy microtransactions to buy more plays.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of people bought that game.
No, because
you know,
it's a bit of a risky move, especially for EA that owns it. Activision?
I think it's Activision.
It's a bit of a risky move for any of those big companies, really. But Activision kind of went out on a limb saying, like, hey, the rhythm game is kind of big right now. We're going to try and capitalize on this. And they put all the microtransactions in it and stuff, hoping that people who bought the game would spend more money. And I've also heard that, like, you kind of don't need to spend that stuff. So it's a sort of thing where it's there for the option of having it.
Yeah.
And it's there so that they can get a little more money, and if they get people's hands on thing, like they get controllers in hands, maybe they'll make a little couple extra bucks. But if it works out at all, they're probably gonna try and make it a franchise, Guitar Hero Live 2, like in next year probably. It's an interesting concept, but like this could go very nightmarish again, just like how they spun off Guitar Hero to death the first time.
Yeah.
All right, Ryan, you're getting sleepy. We're gonna take another really quick break.
Okay,
you can wake up a little bit. We got a couple more questions to go through.
All right,
you ready? Next question.
Next question.
Several to go through here.
Considering
Ryan is sleepy, it's past your bedtime, bro.
Yeah, it's past my bedtime.
Let's just get right into it. I have to admit, this question, because it's on Twitter, I had to censor it a little bit. It's very crude. So,
All right.
If you could have relations with any video game character, who would it be?
Relations.
Yeah, he means like sexual relations, I'm assuming. Oh. Well, based on the word he used, inappropriate. Like I said.
Okay.
So I'll give you Ryan, I'll give you a moment to think about this, but my answer is Princess Peach, because she is just she's the unattainable. She's the one. Like she's just legendary.
She's the
like
one.
She's just like, you know what I'm saying? Like unattainable.
I guess so.
Like,
yeah.
She's legendary.
Yes, Princess Peach is legendary. That's true.
That's it. My also my uncle works at Nintendo. He said if beat the game, you get to see Peach's tits.
Oh shit!
That's part of makes her so legendary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is your answer John Cena?
No, it's definitely, it's my girl Yukiko, dog.
Yukiko, man.
She's my girl.
She's not real, bro.
Neither is Princess Peach.
Yeah, I know, but we're just responding to @RickGeist's question. He just theoretically, Yukiko, just spitballing, man, just theoretically.
Yukiko.
Do you want to tell us something about Yukiko Amagi? And about how she's your waifu?
She's definitely my waifu.
She's your video game waifu, because...
Well, yeah, I have a real-life waifu.
Not real, well... And she's not part of your real life, but she's a... She's your 3D waifu, let's say that.
She's my 3D waifu. Yep, that's true.
Next question...
Next question.
By the way, my waifu is Chie Satonaka.
Oh, I do. You love Chie.
Because I mentioned that my waifu was in Persona 4. I didn't want to give people the wrong idea, so I just wanted to just get that out there. All right, here's Anonymous. He says, I have a simple question for you guys. What is the greatest game of last generation?
Oh, shit.
Really? I've prepared my answer.
I bet you have.
It's one of two things.
Okay.
Do I know what they are?
Yes.
Greatest game of last gen. Okay. I narrowed it down to three. Not necessarily the top.
Well, I thought you said it was
okay,
two.
I thought about it more.
Oh, shit.
Not necessarily the top three, but one of these three games is the best game of last generation.
Okay.
It is either... Bayonetta, or the Elder Scrolls V Skyrim.
Okay.
Or Dark Souls.
Okay. Yep.
One of those.
Not any of those.
What are you thinking?
Ni No Kuni.
Fuck off, Ryan.
I will not. That's the best game.
That's not the best game. It's a turn-based 80-hour. Expressing
Boy,
fest.
Isn't that great?
All right, well, there you go.
Ni No Kuni.
There's our official opinions on the subject. Ryan thinks the best
man's
game.
Official opinion.
Ryan Ni thinks Kuni, best the best game of last generation is an 80-hour expressing fest.
Yep.
Asshole.
That's me. Hello.
Please read the next question.
Okay.
We've
had the new consoles.
Ryan, I'm serious about Skyrim being, like, really... Like, Skyrim's really fucking good, bro.
Yeah, Ni No Kuni, really
okay.
Fucking good.
Okay.
We've had the new consoles for about 2 years now.
Oh, shit, and really?
It's time to decide. PS4, Xbox One, who has the best controller? From Kylie in Sacramento.
Was it PS4, Xbox One, and also who... Is it two separate questions?
No, I'm going to say it's who has the best controller out of PS4 and Xbox One.
Xbox One.
That's what I'm going to say.
Xbox One.
PS4. You're wrong.
Why? Because you like to have a fucking controller that lights up, and if you can't, because you can't remember what controller you are, like, you get, like, anxious. You have social anxiety.
Nope, I think the Xbox One controller is too heavy.
What?
I think it's too heavy.
Okay, can we admit that the Xbox 360 controller is better than both of them?
Absolutely. All right,
I will concede to whatever you just said is true, as long as you admit that the Xbox 360 controller is better than both of them. That's all I care about.
I'm of the opinion that PS4 is tied with Xbox 360. That is my opinion.
Get the fuck out of here. Like, however, Xbox 360 is the greatest controller ever made.
That's definitely false.
What, you, like, you're still, like, stuck on that Sega Genesis shit or something? Like, what? It's the best.
No, I mean, Xbox 360 controller has a shitty D-pad.
It don't need a D-pad. I got one right here.
It don't need a D-pad. Look, I put duct tape over my D-pad.
It don't need one. It's got face saying. Buttons and triggers. And it's battery powered, which is important.
PS4 controller.
Because
better.
Rechargeable controllers are bullshit.
No. Nope.
Well, if you're having, like, a hot game sesh, and you have to plug that shit in because it has to recharge.
Nick, I have four controllers.
But no one else...
Actually, Nick, I have
100.
Five
PS4
controllers.
But you're a fool.
Yes.
But what you need is rechargeable batteries. Which I know you, have. But like,
I also have.
I know, but you have to change the batteries in when you run low. If you're having like a hot game sesh. But like, you have to, like switch controllers, or you don't have more than one controller. It's not cool. Also, hashtag you cannot reward Sony for taking this long to figure out that controllers are supposed to be concave. They were always supposed to be concave. You can't be like, oh, hey, pat him on the head like, oh, you guys finally figured it out, huh? Cool. Best controller ever. It lights up, right?
You know, it would be the literal best controller ever.
The PS4 didn't have soggy L2 and R2. They're just like...
No, if... Okay, so... Best controller ever...
If the share button was an actual button?
Nope. Best controller ever. Hear me out.
I will.
Wii U Pro Controller.
Yes.
Caveat, swap the position of the... What's fucked up on that controller? Swap the position of the face buttons and the right thumbstick.
So it's an Xbox 360 controller?
Yeah, but it has a good D-pad.
It does have a good D-pad. That's true.
Okay, yeah, you ready? Know what? Perfect.
Yeah,
because that controller
shit's also light too, which is that's a check in your controller book.
Controller is 360 triggers.
Yes.
360 button layout. Wii U Pro Controller D-pad. That's the best controller.
Game over. Rechargeable or run on batteries?
Both, to make us both happy.
Nailed it. Next question.
That's the best controller. That's the best controller. Make that controller,
somebody.
Yeah, so somebody.
He asked, he asked specifically about which is the better of the two, but we went a step further, and we invented a controller that's better. So just
The best controller.
Fund it.
It's a Wii U Pro Controller with an Xbox 360 layout.
What?
The Nintendo Wii U D-pad.
Can I ask you a question that Peter asked us?
Yes.
When Bear versus Man turns up, what is their drink of choice? Beer? Vodka? Brown liquor?
Oh, man, Peter. If I'm getting turnt...
Yeah, that's an important distinction, because it's like... Are we just like?
I ain't getting turnt right now. Oh. But like, if I was gonna get turnt, here's how you do it, Ryan style. Drink an entire bottle of wine out of the bottle.
Mm-hmm. If it was in your trunk previously, even better.
Even better. Then you invite Nick to your house either before or after, and you say, "Nick, put whiskey in my glass, please."
That is how you get. This is how Ryan gets turnt. Nick comes to his house and he says, "Hey, Ryan, you want some whiskey?" And then I just pour an indiscriminate amount into a glass with, like, an ice cube, and I force him to drink all of it.
And Ryan drinks it, and then he says, "Nick, I will have another, please." And he says,
"And then, like, okay." And, like, Joe is there, and he's like, "Big mistake." And I'm just like, "Nope, he wanted whiskey. This guy's getting whiskey."
And then I drink a beer.
And then you fall asleep.
And then I fall asleep. That's how Ryan
gets turned. That's how you turn down for what?
It's a combination of red wine and brown liquor.
Oh, I love a good red wine.
Yeah, dude. I love red wine. For real.
I'm not allowed to drink it around here either.
Why?
I'm not allowed to drink it. But if we get a bottle of wine in this household, I have to get white wine.
Oh, fuck off.
My SO doesn't really do red wine.
Yeah, drink your own giant bottle of red wine.
I might.
That's what I have to say about that.
I got like one of those those juice boxes of red wine. And it's like a solid 2.5 glasses of red wine at like 13.5%. And like that shit was alright. Like that shit was pretty good.
Yeah, that's pretty
good. But if I'm like gonna turn up.
Yeah, what are you doing when you're turning up?
There's so many... We're talking about drinking or turning up or whatever. There's a lot of, words that get thrown around in terms of, am I trying to glow? Am I trying to get buzzed? Trying to get drunk? trying to get shit faced, like trying to get smashed,
turning up.
Like I'm trying to get like as drunk as I possibly can, or like trying to take myself to the brink of being too drunk. Okay, so here's I'll describe a couple different scenarios. For the most part, wine is always good. Like I love to just have a good bottle of wine by myself. One time I drank a double bottle of wine by myself, and I entered a place that I call the danger zone. Tom Cruise and I went there because I also drank 2 Bud Light Platinum that night.
Okay.
It was over the course of a long period of time, dude, but like,
yeah, okay.
That was bad. I was sick the next day. Sick enough to the point that I was like, do I also have the flu? Because I'm that sick. But it also could have just been that hungover. I don't actually know. But considering I vomited the night before and I expelled some of the alcohol from my body, I think I may have just actually had the flu at the same time.
Yeah.
But if I'm like... So I don't do spirits.
There's
a point in my college life where I wanted to begin every drinking engagement with like a shot, just to get the ball rolling.
Okay.
I can't really do that anymore, or I don't want to do that anymore. So
I hate shots. So
my drink of choice is like a strong ass beer, like 7% plus. Like, as high as possible. The higher the better, in terms of alcohol by volume. Yep. But as long as it's beer, I will, like I said, I'll throw down with wine. Love a good sangria, because sangria is just wine with fruit and more liquor in it.
That's true, yep.
But it never is, like, I mean, it's possible to make it too heavy, but, like, it's never too overpowering. In my experience, but like, yeah, I mean, like my go-to beers are like 7%+. I've had beers that are like 10% that are like amazing. And like after one of those, you're like, whew. Now, I do have to be careful with those beers though, because you think a beer is a beer, right? Like I had one beer, I had two beers, whatever. Not true. It's a very specific time I went to your home.
I have a home, yes.
And I drank beer from your fridge, and you tricked me into getting fucking wasted. Because
I don't remember.
He didn't trick me, because I think you were also, you had had a few, and so you weren't all there entirely, but I was just like, totally, I'll drink this beer. And I drank, it's a good brewery out of Pennsylvania called Victory. Make a lot of good beers. Favorite of which is...
I have some of their beers in my
fridge. Yes, you do. That's the problem.
Right now.
They have a great beer called Dirt Wolf that I like a lot. I just wanted to tell you that. But you have a beer in your fridge, possibly right now, called Golden Monkey. It's a Belgian-style ale. It's either a double or a triple. And it's like 9% or more. So I was just like kind of casually drinking beers, and I had like one or two of those, not fully recognizing really how much beer 9% alcohol by volume is.
Oh, yeah.
Next thing I know, board game night has concluded. We played a little bit of video games in your basement, and now I'm back home, and I'm trying to listen to podcasts. But I'm so drunk that I go to the bathroom because I think I would be sick while still listening to podcasts, but I'm not sick. I just fall asleep sitting on the bathroom floor, wake up, and then fall asleep on my couch for a couple hours, at which point it's like 4 o'clock in the morning, and my SO is like, why is Nick not in bed yet? And goes and finds me.
So you did well.
And I was like trying to play. I was like drunk enough that I was like, oh, no, I'm good. Like, I'm going to try to play video games. I'm going to try to listen to podcasts. I'm good. I'm totally good. No. Golden monkey. Golden monkey. Like, I turned up. Like, I needed to turn down, but I was so turned up, I could not turn down.
He couldn't turn down for what?
Turn up for down. Like, it. But ultimately, when I want to turn up and have, like, a good time without drinking, like, too much volume or too much, like, nothing, the right balance between too much volume and too strong is, like, a really good, like, 7 to 9%, like, strong beer. You start with something hoppy. You should conclude with something a little bit on the sweeter side, like, a little more full body. That's how I like to turn up. I just wanted to include those stories about how I drank too much Golden Monkey at your house one time.
That's legit.
Generally, that's how family game night goes, is that I start drinking beer, and no one else is really drinking beer, and then I embarrass myself, because we're trying to play, like, a game that requires... Real board games? We're trying to play a board game that either, like, requires cooperation, or... like, bluffing or something, and I'm just, like, a little bit more drunk than everyone else, and it's just embarrassing for me, and everyone just goes, like, yeah, Nick's drunk again, that's cool.
Nick's drunk.
And you're just, like, and then I just, like, leave, and they're, like, Ryan, why the fuck do you invite Nick? He's a fucking drunk asshole. What the fuck, dude?
Yep.
No, you can't tell me that that's true. That's... Okay, next question. It's me self-deprecating and being self-conscious, but you're supposed to tell me, like, nah, dude, fucking Joe and Yuki think it's endearing that you're an alcoholic. Listen, Ryan, I work really hard so that when I have some time off, I want to party hard, too.
Drink the alcohol.
I want to party hard, too.
Yeah. That's okay. Yep. No, okay. That's good.
Yeah. Next question.
Oh, am I supposed to do it? Okay.
Yeah.
What's one game in your backlog that's really bugging you that it's still there? For me, it's Chrono Cross. After all these years, I've never gotten around to it despite loving Chrono Trigger since its release. Thanks, Bradley from Kansas City.
Good pick, Bradley.
Good pick. That is also in my backlog.
I don't know if I actually care about Chrono Cross.
I'm supposed to, because I like RPGs.
Yeah. You probably should. If we're going to complain about RPGs not being turn-based anymore, you pretty much have to play every turn-based RPG. Ever.
So, speaking of those, my official answer is Shadow Hearts.
Yes! God, those are so good.
Yep, it's been in there for so long, and I've, like, never really touched them.
The first, admittedly,
I bought
the first
one and two.
The first one is a little bit bad. They were working out all the details in the first game.
Yeah.
But by the second one, damn, they make a good game. Like, shit, they got their shit together, and they made a good game. Shadow Hearts 2 is really good.
Yeah, that's what people keep telling me.
As for a game, it's in my backlog. Whenever I think of the word backlog, I think of the word Steam as well.
Okay. Yep.
Man, it's a lot of games in my backlog. I own a lot of Steam games, so there's a lot of games that stick out this year. I mentioned previously, like Undertale and Soma, that I really want to make sure I play. But the biggest standard I can think of is probably Transistor. Because I love Bastion so much. And I'm not saying, like, I want that to be Bastion 2 or want it to be more the same or anything. But, like, it's the same people. It's the first game they did after Bastion. Right. So I want to play that game and see what's good with it. But part of what's holding me back... Have I told you the story about PAX East 2014 and the Transistor demo? I must have.
I'm not sure.
I'm almost positive I did. About how Joe and I waited for like an hour in line to play Transistor, yeah, the demo. And I just seen what is involved in the demo and heard the cutscene from the beginning and the end of it so many times. By the time I got to it, I was just like numb.
Yeah, yeah, I can see that.
And then when I play the game, it's like the first 30 minutes of it is that 30-minute demo or whatever.
Right, right.
So when I first played it, I was like, this again. Because it came out like... It came out... So PAX East takes place in like April or so, right?
Yeah, it came out early.
May 21st of the year that I played it at PAX. So like less than a month later.
Right.
And I was just not having it at first. And I beat like the first boss, but I need to go back into that game and play from the beginning and just play it. And try and enjoy
just
it.
Fucking play it.
The other problem is like the voice of the Transistor, like the sword, is also the narrator, yeah, from Bastion. And the narrator from Bastion is just such an iconic role.
Oh yeah, that's like one of the best parts of that game.
Yeah, it's huge. It's part of what, yeah, makes the game stand out so clearly. And just such, right, an important part of that game that like when I hear his voice in any, like, he's not in anything else, but like whenever I hear his voice, I just think narrator from Bastion. It's Rux. But
yeah, totally.
Yeah, I think that is the big standout. I have a long backlist. I have way more games than I've had time to play, but like that's the one that like I don't know why I haven't played this game yet. And that's, I'm hoping to get to it once kind of 2015 is wrapped up, but I've been saying that for a, mm-hmm, while now.
Yeah, yeah.
Shit, man. Now I feel shitty about not having played Transistor.
Yeah, it's okay. You'll be alright.
I'll play Undertale. I'll play Undertale for real, bro.
I want you to play it.
I need to play it. I need to play that game.
Yes, you do.
We got a short email here from Anonymous. He says, fuck sandwiches.
Yeah.
Anonymous, calm the fuck down, okay? Sandwiches are great.
Yeah, man. What sandwiches ever do to you?
He's like probably dog. Bitter because he's on some like weird like low carb diet or something. Like, fuck, whatever, dude. Like sandwiches are great.
Dope.
I'm not gonna say they're the best food. Let me ask you something.
Okay, ask me something.
Is a pizza a sandwich?
No.
What if I take two slices of pizza?
Okay.
And I put them like cheese to cheese.
Okay. Yep.
And I put them inside of a waffle iron.
So you made a calzone.
Oh, shit. But is a calzone a sandwich?
No, it's pizza.
I think a calzone is a sandwich.
I think it's a pizza.
Wait, what? So I turn a pizza into a calzone, but a calzone... Hey, Ryan, as the official anime editor for Bear vs. Man, are there any anime you are looking forward to watching? From Christopher in Halifax, Nova Scotia.
Okay. Yes.
Please tell us what are these animes you want to watch.
I watched exactly 3 episodes of One Punch Man.
I'm very excited to watch
more One Punch Man.
Well, the discussion we had about One Punch Man recently led me to believe you watched way more than that.
No, I watched like 3, maybe 4 episodes.
But you were impressed.
One Punch Man. I'm very impressed. I want to watch more One Punch Man. The other one I want to finish is Assassination Classroom, because that's getting a second season.
Oh, is it the one with the weird yellow alien man?
Yeah, like this weird yellow Cthulhu man, and like Cthulhu everybody goes to school to kill him.
How similar is that to that, like, CBS show How to Get Away with Murder or whatever, where it's, like, the lady teaching a college class to lawyers.
Oh, no, that's like a one-to-one.
It's, like yeah, it's pretty much, like, the
yeah, yeah, like, a, yeah. a one-to-one
Is that the name of that show? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, How to Get Away with Murder.
Maybe that's not what it's called, but, like, you know what I'm referring to, correct?
I believe okay. so, yeah.
It's, like, the lady who's, like, welcome to Murder 101. We're going to teach you how to, like, catch murderers by teaching you how to get... Yeah, okay. Okay.
That's that show. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, yeah. Anyway, we're on the same page
animes. Here. Yep.
Sorry, I have a cold. I mentioned this earlier. So One Punch Man is a big one. Would you be open to watching... We talked about this, I think, on Extra Life. We talked about anime. But would you be open to watching Himoto Umaru-chan? Which is, like, the most anime-ass anime about nothing. It's about that girl who's just straight-up neat, who turns into a hamster girl when she's at home and just plays PSP.
What is it called?
Chips. Himoto, which is... Something
Himoto Umaru-chan?
Yeah, something to do with Himoto's, like, little sister or something like that. And Umaru is her name.
If it's on Hulu, I'll watch it. It's on Hulu.
Is it on Hulu?
Yeah.
That's dope. I didn't even know it was on Hulu.
Yeah, it's on Hulu.
Like,
I will watch
it. It's kind of about nothing. Like, it doesn't have, like, a story like One Piece does or whatever. But just, like, some dumbass anime shit, man. Like... If you're just like, I'm going to watch some fucking dumb anime, can't go wrong with that.
Yep.
It's just...
Nick, can I read you the description for this?
I've seen most of it, so I know what it's about, but please tell me anyways.
Umaru has two faces. That's true. Her outside face is a reserved beauty renowned throughout the school and community for her flawless manners, talent, intelligence... Yep. Her dreaded inside the face her responsible older brother Taihei deals with daily, is a lazy, game-playing, snack-binging brat. As Umaru hides her ability to methodically pair junk food with cola, Taihei attempts to devise ways to rein in her epic laziness by any means necessary. To
rein on it?
Rein in, I'm assuming, like...
First of all, I feel like this is something that you could relate to very well. Because you're a piece of shit. No, I'm just kidding. But, like...
Okay.
The fact that they paint... That description paints her brother as the villain is, like, disgusting.
That's... Yeah,
because he, like, is seriously... Like, she just manipulates him. Like, he just, like, works and supports her solely... And she's just a total piece of shit. He's great. She sucks. It's entertaining. And as for, I'm glad they specifically mentioned the pairing the snack food with the cola, because there's like scenes where she just describes like, you get potato chips, you get cola, you get this other food, and this is how you eat it. This is the right way to eat it. It's like you balance the flavors and the textures, and it's just like, it's so elaborate. And it's just like, who wrote this garbage? This is so good. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
If you want some anime-ass anime, watch it.
I'll watch that.
That's all I'm saying. It's also like I'm not really into the anime world, per se. I know there was a... Do you remember that old-ass anime... Full Metal Panic?
Yes. Yeah.
I don't think I ever watched it, but I, like, know it. It got, like, a spin-off series where, like, some of the not-human characters, like, have this theme park or something.
Something like that, yeah.
That's some anime shit. Like, anime I used to be shit. Way more into anime than I was now. There's still some I like, and like some I can really appreciate because it's like funny or interesting, but some of it I'm just like...
No, I have like...
I just look at it and I'm like, what? What is this?
I have like a passive, like, I want to watch some animes because they're specifically interesting, but I don't just want to be like, animes are dope.
You ever watch Death Note?
I love Death Note.
I read Death Note. I never watched the whole thing, but, like, holy shit, that's good.
Death Note's great, yeah.
Oh, shit. Yeah, dude, listen, Christopher, you haven't seen Death Note? Go fuck yourself. It's on Netflix.
It's on Netflix and Hulu, and probably Crunchyroll.
Dude, Death Note is just... Death Note is the bastion of anime.
A little bit, yeah. No, definitely.
We're down to our last question here, guys.
All right.
Which is good, because Ryan is just the sleepiest dude.
Ryan's the sleepiest dude.
I know you guys have said in the past that you're adults with no time for long video games. So you guys should share with the class, your favorite short video games. I'm talking like 2 to 4 hours. You know, I read this question before I put it in here, and the only thing that came to mind when we talk about short video games is, so Bastion is not 2 to 4 hours. It's probably more like 5 or 6. Yep. But like, it's still relatively short, and ultimately for like, it's like, I can't get what this question is coming from. They want to know about number of minutes spent. But ultimately, I think that a game, you evaluate its shortness or its longness based on how short or long it feels.
Okay,
and yeah. Bastion feels like a short game. Like, you just play it, and definitely. You're like, fuck, it's over? What? It's just, it's over. Like, it's not a long game, and it's, you can't clear it in one sitting, per se. But it feels shorter than most games. That's the first thing that came to mind. I'm sure if I thought about it a little bit longer, I could think of something else. So how about you comment on this while I like scroll through my Steam library and jog my memory a little bit.
Okay, so in the same vein, Undertale also feels like a short game despite being longer. It's a nice condensed version of a turn-based RPG, which is great. Her Story.
Yes.
It's a great way to spend a couple hours.
Because that game also is as long as you want it to be. In like the weirdest way. And that's like kind of really cool.
There's definitely like a point where you're like, I'm pretty sure I'm done now. But you can keep looking.
I'm trying to think of like a specifically like a one sitting game.
Yeah.
And I'm having a little bit of trouble, although I know that they exist, and there is a couple that I like.
Yeah.
I think that's really cool. I know there's this game called Home that is a one-sitting game. I haven't played it myself. I've heard good things about it. So also,
Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, that's a very short game.
Yeah, if you just, I mean, just like, one sitting, you sit down and play that game, and like, before you know it, you'll have a gigantic beard, and your loved ones will have left you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, just one sitting.
I mean, Risk of Rain kind of falls in that category, but you have to, like, beat it.
What does?
Risk of Rain.
That is true. I almost, like I almost did on our extra life stream.
Oh, you almost beat that game.
I was just like, everyone's getting a beer or whatever. I'll just, like, play this game real quick. And then I almost beat it. I was playing, like, for, like, 40 minutes. Stupid.
You did. And we were like, it's fucking die, Nick.
Stupid. I was like, Jesus. I hope I die soon. It was ridiculous. but I also didn't want to, like, just give up.
No, you definitely could have,
So the game, is Jazz Punk a one-session game?
Oh, totally, yeah.
That falls in the category, right?
Yes, yeah.
Oh, what was it?
Grow Home, similarly, is very short.
Is that really that short? Like, under 4 hours?
Yes. Oh, definitely, yeah.
Oh, dope. Downwell doesn't count.
No.
Oh, because it's like too arcadey to really count. I just thought of a really good example, but I cannot remember for the life of me now.
I played Grow Home for exactly 2 hours.
And you like, whoa, I really need to play Grow Home.
Grow Home's great. You should play that game.
I was really relieved to see. So there's this game that came out this year, Cybele. Did I already mention that? Like, within the past 3 hours we've been doing this?
You may.
You did.
Have.
I was super relieved. I thought it was, like, a regular length game. I was super relieved to hear that it was a one-sitting type of game.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I know I bought that for, like, $7, but, like, just based on how much time I have to spend, like, splitting time between, like, working, spending time with friends and family, loved ones,
yeah,
recording this podcast, and playing video games, like, just being able to be like, hey, here's this game that you're going to finish in one sitting. I'm just like, oh, thank God.
Fuck yeah.
You know, because I also love that idea of having a full experience, like, feeling, like, getting a whole story and, like, feeling a full range of emotions in just a couple of hours. That's incredible, because that's super hard to do from the perspective of someone who writes stories.
How to Full Boyfriend. That's a great game.
Yeah, that's the kind of game that you could spend an hour playing it. You could spend 8 hours playing it. You can play it multiple times, but you get, like, a full run through. That is a good example. That's good.
Yeah.
What was the one I was thinking of?
I don't know.
I don't know either. Please Don't Touch Anything? I haven't played that game before. I just haven't.
I want to play that game. Yeah.
I have it, but I haven't played it yet. I know Soma is, like, a kind of a long-ass game.
Mm-hmm.
Guys, I had a really good example, and I cannot remember it now.
Well, it's gone.
This short, when we talk about short games, one that comes to mind that I haven't played myself, I don't even know if I own it, but 30 Flights of Loving? Have you heard of that game?
I don't know that game, no.
30 Flights of Loving is a game, it's kind of akin to Jazz Punk, and it's
I like Jazz Punk.
A very short game. It's like 15 to 20 minutes, which... But you also have to buy it, so it's polarizing in terms of you going, like, is this game worth it at all?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And that can be a tough decision to make. But as we said before, we like short games because sometimes we just don't have time for that shit.
That's true. Yep.
Oh, man... Super bummed.
It's bedtime.
Well, what about Maple Story? I heard that game's pretty short.
Fuck that game.
Mushinarium is a cool wordless adventure game that, depending on your aptitude, takes maybe 4 hours. That fits the bill, whether you know it or not. Gone Home, huh? I can play that on
Grow.
Ooh, Home. Gone Home.
Oh yeah.
I played that game for 2 hours. That is a good example of a short game. You get a full... Right. That's exactly what I was describing, actually. It wasn't what I was thinking of. But you get the full experience, the full story, the full range of emotions. That's pretty good. Dear Esther. This game takes like 60 to 90 minutes. That is... Maybe not a actual game. But in 60 to 90 minutes, okay, you will experience a story. How about that? It's like,
that works. Yeah, no, that counts. Yeah, that's what games are.
Steamroll Dig? Never mind. Okay, never mind. I'm going to stop.
Bedtime. Guys,
we've been drinking a lot. We answered questions. We bullshitted. Beer vs. Mancast, episode 2, part 2, is drawn to an end.
Yes.
I want all of you guys to have a wonderful holiday and a great new year.
Yes.
Because we're kind of spitballing here as amateur podcasters. We don't know really the schedule of anything that's going to happen. So we'll see you near the new year or after the new year. I don't know.
We're going to be here.
Yeah, like, follow us on Twitter and find out when we going to be at. I don't really know what to tell you guys, honestly.
Yeah. Twitter. Bear versus Man. Send us more emails.
By the way, questions at
bearversusman.com.
Is it her story, right? So I only played that game for 3 hours. And like, that game is fucking dope. Okay, all right. At Bear versus Man, that's really the only one that matters.
Yep, yeah, everything else is negotiable. That's
Bear vs. Man.
Mm-hmm.
I have complete faith in you guys to figure it out.
I do too.
I love you all.
Rate us on iTunes.
Yes.
Please.
Yes.
We love you.
We're on YouTube. Like it if you big feel smooches. Like it. But like, ultimately the big one, go to iTunes.
And smooch us with 5-star ratings.
Good size smooches.
And we'll smooch you back.
Good night, everyone.
Bye.